It's that time of the year again. It's Christmas, so you know what that means. Spending all of your money and getting fat. But with it being December, of course that also means that I've got a cold. Because I couldn't just record a 30-minute plus video and not have a cold. That'd be too easy. But it also means that it's a good excuse to watch some good old-fashioned, family-friendly, festive movies. And no, I'm not talking about Elf, Home Alone, The Muppet Christmas Carol, The Santa Claus, and, Jingle All the Way. And when you think about it, the idea of Christmas is actually kind of terrifying. This large man, dressed in all red, who has an army of enslaved elvish creatures to do whatever he wants, once a year flies through the sky with horned beasts, breaking into people's homes and leaving behind little packages for children to open. Sounds a bit demonic to me. And thanks to the good old people over at Twitter and on my Discord server, two things you should really be a part of, by the way, we're gonna celebrate Christmas our way. Blood, guts, and really questionable movies. I asked my viewers, what are some good horror, Christmas-related movies that I should check out? And because they love me and really care about me, they only suggested the utmost best top-quality movies for me to watch. Right? So that's what we're gonna be doing today. I picked a few, each for various different reasons, and I'll be checking them out to get myself into the holiday spirit. Because nothing bad ever happens at Christmas. For the first movie, let's start off a little weird. Jack Frost, a serial-killing snowman. Yeah, it doesn't get much weirder than that. It's what looks to be a comedy horror movie from 1997, and not to be confused with the 1998 movie of the same name, that is definitely not a comedy horror movie. I spent more time than I care to admit being confused while researching this. So let's sit back and give this a go and see if it tis the season to turn off this movie and never watch it again. Well, that was certainly an interesting watch. I especially like the part where the snowman f***ing killed like a dozen people. So this highly prestigious and artistic plot revolves around serial killer turned snowman who goes around killing people. Jack was a serial killer who drifted from town to town murdering folk, but was eventually caught after putting bits of his victims in pies for sale. On the way to his execution, the transport truck gets into a wreck after being forced to drive through a blizzard, resulting in perhaps one of the best edits that I've ever seen in any movie ever. The truck they collided with sprays Jack with a bunch of chemicals that melts off his face and turns him into mush. Said mush then soaks into the snow, resulting in Jack being turned into a snowman. Trust me, it's 100% scientifically accurate. I checked. And he uses his newfound snowman form to continue doing what he loves doing the most. Good old-fashioned murder. He then goes on a spree where he terrorizes the town of Snowmanton. No, seriously, it's called that. He kills an unsuspecting kid by pushing him over, resulting in a sled decapitating him. Oh, they sure don't make sleds like they used to anymore. I miss the days when they came fitted with your own personal guillotine. He then kills the kid's grieving dad by forcing an axe handle down his throat, before turning the attention to the mum, strangling her with Christmas lights and repeatedly smashing her face into a pile of glass, because f*** this family in particular. Of course, the acting is just completely overplayed and hammed up, to the point where it actually fits the wackiness of this movie perfectly, without just making it feel like it's terribly acted. If you haven't deduced by now with your excellent detective skills, it's a comedy horror, just in case the serial killer turned snowman wasn't enough for you. And it's one of those terrible but also kind of enjoyable movies that would be best enjoyed with a couple of buddies and a few beers. Shame I have neither of those things. The idea of a killer snowman roaming around a town called Snowmanton, preying on its residents and spouting off quippy one-liners as if it's Bruce Campbell, is honestly as entertaining as it sounds. There's an overarching plot of the FBI being responsible for the chemical that turned Jack, but to be honest, it's pretty irrelevant, and that goes for the whole story, to be honest. Show me funny snowman do the kill. And despite those totally tubular 90s haircuts, that's a thing people said in the 90s, right? The kills are the best thing about this movie. Although I would be lying if I said there weren't some serious missed opportunities, with the fact that he can actually liquefy and freeze himself at will. There's a scene that I overthought in my head too much, to the point where the actual scene could never live up to it. There's this scene where a character breaks off some ice to put into a drink, making me think that perhaps somebody would drink that drink, and then Jack would regain his form while inside of them, causing them to explode from the inside out, or something equally as cool as that. But nope, he shoots him through the head with a projectile icicle. I mean, projectile icicles is kinda cool, but not as cool as exploding from the inside out. But the concept isn't entirely wasted, as there's this time where Jack forms back into a snowman as a woman takes a bath, resulting in her arms being stuck inside of Jack as he repeatedly smacks her head against the wall, but in this clearly laughable way where he's obviously not using any force to save this actor from injury. We do kind of get something like what I was wanting. Jack somewhat possesses a man for a few moments, before then being spewed out onto the floor. But the possession happens completely off camera, and being puked out onto the ground doesn't quite have the same ring to it as exploded from the inside out. You know what, all in all, a fun festive movie that you should absolutely watch with the whole family. The kids will love it. And here's something else the kids will love. God, I'm good at this. This video sponsor, Displate. Displate is a one-of-a-kind metal poster designed to capture your unique passions. They've created a 21st century canvas that's sturdy, magnet-mounted, and durable enough to withstand a lifetime of intense staring. And if you're anything like me, you'll do a lot of blank staring into space. But staring is only half of the fun. You can customize, collect, and rearrange them all at will. It only takes 20 seconds to set them up, with no power tools, no damages, and no frustrations. Because believe me, we could all use less frustrations in life. No matter what you're interested in, chances are Displate has you covered. From your favorite video games, TV shows, movies, and comic books, some of the Displate collections include Star Wars, Marvel, DC, Fallout, The Elder Scrolls, and The Witcher. And that's just scratching the surface of what Displate has to offer for you. Not to mention, Displate plant one tree for every Displate sold, and so far they've planted over 14 million trees. And I'm a fan of trees, we need them to breathe. The mounting process is unbelievably simple and easy, with no power tools necessary. First, wipe down the area of the wall where you plan to display your Displate with the cleaning wipe. Apply the protective leaf to the wall, and then press the magnet to the area for roughly 5 seconds or so. No holes, no damage, and no hassle. It's that simple. And if you use my link down below, you'll get 23% off for every 1-2 purchases, and 29% off for 3 plus purchases. So make sure you check out using the link below. So apparently in recent years, there's been this whole memo that I missed that stated if you're going to do a Christmas horror movie, it needs to be about Krampus. Whatever a Krampus is, but I'm sure I'm about to find out. And just looking at a few online articles, I learnt that there's a whole lot of Krampus movies floating around out there. It's giving off serious Conjuring, Annabelle, and The Nun vibes, where for a few years there were like 50 horror movies all following the same basic premise. I guess I missed that memo too. And after being told to do a Krampus movie, when looking into which one I should potentially cover, my brain was confronted with the sheer amount of movies that contain the subject matter, which was overwhelming and made me feel sweaty in places that I shouldn't be sweating. So to keep things easy for my sweaty little body, I decided to go with the one simply named Krampus. That should get straight to the point, right? But it also caught my interest because it has Toni Collette in it, who also appeared in Hereditary, one of the best horror movies of the past decade, by the way, and Adam Scott from the undeniable classic, perhaps the Citizen Kane of our generation, Hot Tub Time Machine 2. But first of all, before I jump headfirst into all of this, what is a Krampus? Krampus is a horned, anthropomorphic figure in Alpine folklore who during the Christmas season scares children who have misbehaved. Assisting Saint Nicholas, the pair visit children on the night of the 5th of December, with Saint Nicholas rewarding the well-behaved children with modest gifts such as oranges, dried fruit, walnuts and chocolate, while the badly behaved ones only receive punishment from Krampus with birch rods. Saint Nick the straight-up savage, you either get dried fruit or a whipping. I'm pretty sure that's how BDSM kinks are created. Hold up. What happened to the Krampus who only whipped naughty kids with birch branches, and when was he replaced with the Krampus who f***ing kills kids? So the movie sets the scene by introducing us to a family dealing with the usual stresses of Christmas. People. It's always people. Max, one of the youngest of the kids, is at the age where he knows the big red man isn't real, but he's still at the age where he wants to hold on to the magic of it all. After a particularly bad family dinner with his cousins, with them finding his letter to Santa and reading it out loud to embarrass him, he tears up the letter and throws it out of the window, followed by a blizzard instantly forming that knocks out the whole block's power. So basically, every bad thing that occurs from here on onwards is these two's fault. Nice one. Way to ruin Christmas. Kids crying now. Beth, Max's older sister, heads out into the storm to go and see her boyfriend, but things don't seem quite right. I'm not sure that it's the smartest idea to go out alone in a storm that's just appeared overnight, where you can barely see 2 feet in front of you and the icicles dangling from the houses are bigger than you. Now come on, that's just bad parenting. There's no sign of life, no cars, no people in windows, nothing. It's as if the entire street has been placed in some kind of alternate dimension. A cold one. We then get our first look at Krampus, and you better savour it now while you still can, because this'll be the last time we see the titular character until about the last 10-minute mark. That's like naming a movie Madagascar, and then not having it set in Madagascar. Wait, they did that. After being chased by this enormous creature, she hides under a truck in the middle of the road, before she's then attacked by this baby Yoda-looking thing, and never seen again. Like, seriously, she's gone now. So we just, like, straight up killing kids now. Okay. Tom, her dad, and Howard, her uncle, go out looking for her, but Howard ends up getting attacked by some sort of snow-dwelling creature, but it flees after getting shot by Tom. And oh yeah, they've both got guns now, because Howard is a true red-blooded American who takes shotguns and revolvers with him on the Christmas holidays. I wonder what his Easter is like. Later that night, after Howie gets sucked up the chimney chute due to being lured there by a gingerbread man, cause haha, chubby kid, Tom's mother begins to explain that when she was a kid, Krampus came and took her parents away to the underworld as a reminder of what happens when the Christmas spirit dies. What happened to a lump of coal in a stocking? Don't you think that dragging my mother and father to the depths of hell to be tortured for eternity is a little bit extreme? So basically, he's being sent to punish you for not giving in to the corporate spirit and spending a small fortune for the sake of a holiday. The rest of the movie is basically just ensuing shenanigans with enormous child-eating slug clowns, angel doll bird things, killer teddy bears, sentient gingerbread men with nail guns, and demonic Oompa Loompas. Basically, it's like an entire Toys R Us if it was held under demonic possession. Yeah, it gets wild for a second. It goes from, oh no, where's my daughter, to Small Soldiers, the horror movie. For a movie called Krampus, there's a whole lot of not Krampus. He eventually shows up to give the old woman a bit of a lick, and holy shit, I promise I've been a good boy this year. Everyone gets snatched up by the demonic Oompa Loompas and snow creatures. Krampus then confronts Max to give him a bit of a lick, but instead gives him back his torn up letter to Santa. Hey kid, don't believe in Santa anymore? F*** your entire family. Max pleads with naughty Santa to take him instead of his family, but Krampus drops him into a literal hell pit before he then wakes up in bed on Christmas Day because apparently it was all just one big dream. Or was it? Nah, kids in hell. You thought that this was gonna be a fartsy-smartsy happy ending that would have brought the family closer together and they would have all lived happily ever after learning the importance of the Christmas spirit and all of that. They even took the baby. I'll give the movie credit where credit is due for not giving you that stereotypical Hollywood ending of everything all working out in the end. They are dealing with an enormous, ancient, anthropomorphic, people-stealing creature. I don't care how much Murican is running through your veins. You're not shotgunning yourself out of this one. But what I won't give the movie credit for its use of Krampus. Dude's barely even here. The weird demonic creatures and toys trying to eat everyone was a nice touch. I especially liked the child-eating slug clown. I just wanted to give him a little pat on the head. But the first time that Krampus showed up, the size of him, the ability to jump from one place to the next with ease, a large, intimidating, unstoppable force. I just wanted more of that. I think the movie really should have been named Krampus and Friends Happy Holiday Special. How could I go and do a video about Christmas horror movies and not go and include one of the very first slasher movies? Hey, it does feature two of my favourite things, Christmas and death. Wait, I'm sure all of you purist horror movie slasher historians are already running to the comments to tell me, "Will, you beautiful, sexy, and handsome man, it appears that you've made a minor error in stating that this is one of the first slasher movies. It isn't even the first Christmas slasher movie." To that I say, thank you, it does wonders for my self-esteem. And yeah, the genre had been around for about 14 years prior to this movie, and lots of those movies absolutely deserve the respect and praise for their importance to shaping the genre. But this came before what people would refer to as the golden age of slashers, where we got the Halloweens and the Friday the 13ths of the world that would quickly lead into the Bronze Age with the pure amount of schlock that would attempt to capitalize on their success. I know Silent Night, Bloody Night, not to be confused with Silent Night, Deadly Night, came out 2 years previous to this, and is also a slasher movie that takes place around Christmas. But look, this one looks more fun, and that's what we're here for, right? Good old-fashioned murderous fun. So let's find out if my assumption was right, and there's actually any fun to be had here. Well, kinda. The slasher genre didn't really come into its own until the early 80s, and when you watch anything slasher from before then, there's a good chance that it's 60% crime and drama, 30% dudes talking in a room, and 10% actual slasher. And that's sort of what you end up getting here. A story made up of about three different subplots, each of which don't actually go anywhere and remain unfinished by the time the movie comes to an end. There's this guy who just kind of appears to look for his daughter after she's killed, and after being made to think that he's going to play a somewhat prominent role in the story, he kind of just pieces out at the halfway mark. One of the main characters, Jess, tells her boyfriend that she's pregnant, he wants to keep it and be a dad, but she's much more fond of the old fetus deletus approach, kind of sending him off the rails a little bit. Okay, that one does play a role in the story somewhat. And there's this whole section where the town gets together to look for a missing high school girl, which does end up getting resolved when they find her dead body. It doesn't get much more resolved than that. But it doesn't really serve any purpose to the main plot whatsoever. Rather, it actually draws your attention away from the main plot, which is a shame because when it comes down to its bare bones, it's pretty good. Some guy filming a heavy breathing ASMR video sneaks up the side of a sorority house and climbs his way into the attic. The women of the house then receive a phone call from who I assume is the way ahead of his time ASMR guy, giving them some of his best material. If only he knew what the world would be like 40 years from then. One of the sorority women named Claire goes up to her room to play with her pussy. Oh god, what is my life? She ends up getting attacked by somebody hiding in her wardrobe, who proceeds to suffocate her to death with a plastic bag before taking her body to the attic, where he then sits her in a rocking chair facing the window. So when I was dividing up those percentages before, I should have sprinkled in like 3% comedy, because apparently this movie is just going for every genre that it can hit. Only 3% because, much like the subplots and my attention span, the movie just kind of forgets that that was a thing that it was doing and goes to browse Twitter or something stupid. The comedy elements mainly just consist of the house mother's Miss Max alcoholism anyway, because I guess it's funny that she's supposed to be the responsible one. That is, until she goes up into the attic thinking she can hear the cat, but instead of the cat, she ends up coming across Claire's dead corpse. A corpse who I assumed up until this point had still been in the bedroom where she was killed, which explains why I was questioning these idiots and thinking, why haven't they checked her bedroom before contacting the police? Surprise, surprise. I'm the idiot. Miss Mac is killed as a hook gets sneezed into her face. No, he literally sneezes as he throws it at her. Like, what does he think he's doing? Playing Skyrim Allergy Edition? Throughout the movie, the creepy attic-dwelling ASMR guy has been making deranged phone calls to the house and harassing the women. It doesn't seem like anything exclusively perverted like you might expect, but more along the lines of somebody who has an incredibly demented mind and shouldn't be allowed anywhere near a phone. And if he's supposed to be in the same house as these women, why's nobody noticed the insanely disturbed screaming noises that switch in and out of different characters coming from upstairs? I don't care how good the insulation in your walls or ceilings may be, this guy's screaming about as loud as a 14-year-old spouting out racial expletives in a Call of Duty lobby. After a few more woman killings from the original incel, the police eventually figure out that the calls are coming from the same house. And after telling Jess, she's finally able to do something about her hate for ASMR. Like, get out of my ears. She finds the killer and squishes him behind a door before making a run for it. I've gotta say, I love how they never show you the actual killer. The most you'll ever get is a shadow, and in this scene, a terrifying shot of his eyeball. I don't know how an eyeball can be unsettling, but they manage that here. Even though that's all you can see of him, I was like, yeah, that matches the deranged personality. She ends up locking herself in the basement when her boyfriend shows up and decides that it's a bright idea to smash through the glass. A bit strange, to be honest. Surely he's not that desperate for a booty call. And by the time the police arrive, they find him laying dead on top of Jess's unconscious body. And instead of doing the smart thing and probably the standard procedure thing, instead of taking her to the hospital to be checked over and spend the night after being knocked unconscious by a supposedly deranged serial killer, the police sedate her and leave her at the house. That's the literal embodiment of, fuck it, I'll deal with it in the morning. The camera then pans to the attic, where we see the killer is very much still alive, where we then get a shot of the house, just as the phone begins to ring once more, undoubtedly another deranged call from Attic ASMR Man, just as the credits play the movie out. Silent Night, Deadly Night, not to be confused with Silent Night, Bloody Night, is a Christmas movie that sounded interesting to me because of controversy. Can you tell that I was one of those little shit kids that would just say obscene stuff to piss people off for my own amusement yet? So from what I can gather, before its release in the early 80s, the movie would whirl up quite a fuss due to its advertising campaigns, posters, and TV advert spots. Because if you haven't guessed by now, it's a horror movie about someone dressed as Santa. Man, the 80s were wild. You could smoke and drink while pregnant, beat the shit out of your kids, and straight up discriminate against someone because of their sexuality. But boy oh boy, if you mess with our dear old Saint Nicholas, there's gonna be consequences. Okay, what Silent Night, Deadly Night, not to be confused with Silent Night, Holy Night, really is a cautionary tale about untreated mental health issues and the effect that traumatic events can have on the brain. Maybe that's why the movie was boycotted. What easier way to fix a problem than to pretend it just doesn't exist? It's about a young boy named Billy, who ends up having a pretty bad night, and a pretty bad rest of his life, to be honest. The bad night starts on Christmas Eve, when Billy and his family go to see his grandfather in a mental facility, and when nobody is looking, he terrifies the young boy by telling him that Santa only gives presents to kids that have been good all year round, and severely punishes the rest of them. Oh, Grandpa, up to his old children traumatizing hijinks. While on their way home, the family pull over to help someone out in a Santa costume whose car has broken down. But apparently there wasn't enough milk and cookies left out for Santa this year, as he proceeds to then shoot into the car, killing the father, before then pulling the mother out of the car, ripping open her t-shirt, then slitting her throat as a terrified Billy watches from the bushes. Yeah, I guess that's gonna make your night pretty bad. The next few years aren't exactly great for Billy, as he's forced to live in an orphanage run by nuns, where he's repeatedly punished by the head nun for being pretty messed up from the whole having both of his parents savagely murdered in front of him thing. Yeah, the old repeatedly punish and beat the traumatized child method that always works and always turns them into God-fearing, law-abiding, productive members of society. He's killing people. 10 years pass, and one of the nicer nuns at the orphanage helps secure him a job working in a warehouse of a local toy store. The only problem being is that a toy store probably isn't the best place to be working come Christmas time, when there's nothing you hate more in this world than Christmas time, especially as the role falls onto him to be the Santa for all of the kids to come and see. You know, the psychologically damaged guy who's deathly afraid of Santa. This should be fun. And by fun, I mean Billy tells a girl that she will be severely punished if she's naughty. I too enjoy terrifying children. The store finally comes to a close on Christmas Eve, after a presumably long and hard season, so the team are all staying behind to have a few drinks to celebrate. Billy, still dressed in his Santa suit, sees Pamela, a co-worker who he's got a crush on, and Andy, a co-worker who he doesn't have a crush on, but in fact doesn't like very much due to the way he's been treating him, both making out down the other end of the store. This seems to upset Billy, upsets him to the point that it manages to destroy the quality of the footage for a few scenes. An emotion so strong that it persists through the rest of the movie. One minute we're in glorious HD, and the next we're wondering who turned out the lights. They head into the back storeroom, and being the pervy, mentally unstable Santa that he is, Billy follows them in there and witnesses Andy attempting to assault Pamela by pulling off her clothes and trying to force himself onto her. Being reminiscent of what happened to his mother before she got her throat cut, and seeing as this is the season of giving, he's going to be giving them a bit of death. He saves Pamela by wrapping Christmas lights around Andy's neck and lifting him from the ground with one hand, because apparently working in a toy store makes you absolutely yoked. Before he then unsaves Pamela by taking a box cutter and gutting her with it. Before then sneaking up on his boss and planting a hammer into his skull, ruining any chances of getting that promotion. That leaves one more co-worker in the store with Billy, and after she finds the dead boss and takes the axe from Billy, he shoots her in the back with a bow and arrow, because apparently that's a thing you can buy in a toy store? I don't know, man, the 80s were different. Back in the day when kids were tough, roaming around the neighborhood with loaded shotguns, samurai swords, and bow and arrows. The good old days. The story progression part kinda takes a backseat from here on out. The movie's taken over half of its runtime getting to the actual slasher parts, so it's gonna use the last half of its runtime for purely slasher parts. He kills a couple of love young making babysitters, because after all, this is an 80s slasher flick. We've gotta meet our boob quota and include unnecessary sex scenes. He then decapitates some guy on a sled, as his friend does one of the most hilarious screams that I've ever heard in a movie. Before then deciding to head to the orphanage, where the ultimate evil lays. Religion and children. Gross, I think I just threw up a little bit. But he doesn't make it before the police, who with the help of one of the nuns who was actually nice to Billy, now believe they know who the killer is. And as the police arrive at the orphanage, they shoot dead an elderly deaf man dressed as Santa in front of a group of children, because fuck old people. As the ageist police officer is searching the grounds, Billy politely axes the man a question, before making his way into the orphanage with all of the kids and the head nun. But before he can go all Anakin Skywalker versus younglings on the place, he's shot and killed by the police officer with the kind nun, and dies right in front of his brother, who was just a baby at the time of their parents' killing, with the Christmas-hating murder spree doomed to be a repeating cycle. So I originally intended to cover 6 movies for this video, but let's be real, who's got that much Christmas spirit? But the more I thought about doing 6, the more hard work that sounded like it was going to be. And hard work? Me? So instead, I took to the channel's Discord and made a poll. Join the Discord, by the way. We do riveting activities like conduct polls. The options included A Christmas Horror Story, yet another movie featuring Krampus by the looks of things, and Santa's Sleigh, yet another movie about a homicidal Santa. Here at Big Will, I strive for originality. The overwhelming majority of people ended up voting for A Christmas Horror Story, so that's what we'll be finishing off the Christmas video with. And looking at some screenshots of this movie, it certainly looks interesting. Good old Saint Nick looks like he's about to square up against big old nasty Krampus and sock him one in the jaw. So let's see if it's as fun as it looks with the Santa versus Krampus cage match, or are we gonna end up with 2 Power Ranger villains in suits awkwardly thumping each other? I'll be honest with you, I didn't like this one. I don't know, maybe other people thought it was good, but it basically bored me every single step of the way, up until about the last 5 minutes of the movie, where I then saw something that could have actually been great if they just actually pursued that instead of whatever else this is. So I don't actually know what's worse, not liking the whole thing, or not liking the whole thing and then seeing something that could have genuinely made this an enjoyable watch. It follows 5 different storylines. Yes, 5 different storylines, and constantly switches back and forth between them, like after every scene. Now I know other more successful movies have done this in the past, and have done it arguably much better than it's done here, but my stupid caveman Ooga Booga monkey brain has a hard enough time watching 1 bad storyline, never mind 5. Some people would say that that's too many storylines. I'm some people, that's too many storylines. We've got one that's basically just William Shatner playing a radio host. He sits in a chair for the entirety of the movie, so unfortunately that means no Captain Kirk versus Gorn badassery to be seen here, but he does grace us with his buttery smooth voice that can occasionally be heard on the radios throughout the other storylines. You see, we've got continuity. That must mean it's good. It crisscrosses back and forth between the stories to the point where it's actually pretty hard to be engrossed into any of them. 1 minute you're watching Ghost Fuckers, and the next you're watching Santa decapitate a bunch of elves. It'll make sense in a minute. Kinda. But for the sake of actually making things somewhat followable, I'll talk about each story individually, because my god, I wish the movie did it that way. A group of friends are sneaking into a school to film a report about an unsolved double murder that took place here last year. They then make their way down into the lower, unused parts of the school, where they find the room where the murders took place. But along the way, it's clear that they're not alone, as we can see that they're being watched by a ghost girl. Because now this is a ghost story that has absolutely nothing to do with Christmas, in a movie that's supposed to be about Christmas. I respect that it's got the balls to do that. You thought you were watching a Christmas-related horror movie? Well, now you're watching Paranormal Activity Part 34. When they decide that they're done trespassing alone in a haunted school where an unsolved double murder occurred, they find that they're locked down there with no way out. The girl that they're with starts to have a fit after seeing this creepy face, and her friends decide that the best course of action to take right now is to take a nap. Personally, I'd be finding something to break that door open with so I don't end up being some ghost girl's lunch, but if you need your beauty sleep, go for it. As the guys are napping while their female friend is unconscious and potentially more brain damaged by the minute if she's not breathing, but don't worry about it guys, she wakes one of them up, but something's clearly different about her. She tries to seduce him, but after he rejects her, the crucifix on the wall begins to shake, because remember, Jesus is always watching. She goes back to the other room and successfully seduces the other guy, because he's just a fiend for possessed by a ghost girl sex, but she then snaps back to herself, all confused by what just happened. They then find their other friend dead, with the crucifix in his skull, because Jesus is really watching now, before the ghost girl then appears and breaks the boy's neck. The ghost girl kindly unlocks the door, allowing the other girl to leave, because when she possessed her before and had sex with the other boy, she's now carrying her ghost baby. And wow, when I break these stories down individually, they really haven't got all that much substance. Like, that was it. On to number two, I guess. The next one is about a family who sneaks onto somebody's private property to cut down a Christmas tree. And after their son wanders off and they find him again, a bunch of weird things begin to happen back at home, because you guessed it, that's not their son anymore. He stabs his dad in the hand, because he just wanted to eat his damn spaghetti. He inappropriately does things to his mother as she sleeps. Wait, am I watching the right movie? And, oh yeah, he crawls across the ceiling before killing the father. You know, the classic Christmas tale of the kid who wandered off into the woods to be replaced by some kind of mother-fondling, father-murdering, shape-shifting creature. You know, a classic. And then there's this really underwhelming story about Krampus, who basically does what Krampus does, and starts f***ing up an entire family for fun. The family end up getting their car trapped in the snow in the middle of nowhere, and then people die. It turns out they're all pretty crappy people, with the son being a serial killer in the making, who likes to murder all of the family pets. He gets yoinked into the woods. The dad's a fraud who's been taking money from investors for a company that's been bust for years, and just attempted to swindle his wealthy aunt in a last-ditch effort to make some money. He gets yoinked out of a church window. The mother, well, the mother didn't really do anything wrong that we know of. She's actually pretty selfless, which ends up getting her killed. She gets manhandled to death and then licked by Krampus. The daughter's a kleptomaniac who actually manages to impale Krampus before burning him alive, because this ancient demonic creature is apparently able to be outsmarted by a teenage girl. She turns into Krampus. Yeah, don't ask why, story reasons and all that crap. And then there's the storyline that had the most potential to be good, but somehow managed to be the most disappointing because of it. Remember the Santa Claus Krampus cage match? Well, that's this one. It's Christmas Eve at Santa's workshop, just like the many hundreds that have came before it. Except it isn't. Zombie elves. An infection breaks out amongst the elves, and Santa basically goes on a mission to purify. He hacks, slashes, dismembers, and decapitates his way through the undead army of elves. And at one point, he takes the head of an already dead zombie elf and uses it to bash in the brains of another zombie elf. Like, really super cool and all that, but I'm pretty sure that violates the Geneva Convention. The infection even manages to make its way to sweet little Miss Claus, and Santa is forced to break her neck and chop off her head. After all of the elf killing, he eventually finds himself confronted by Krampus, or should I say an angry teenage girl. And the pair finally proceed to fight each other, the premise that sold me on this entire movie, by the way, happening in the last 10 minutes. But as he's about to deal the final blow, he makes like Eminem and snaps back into reality to reveal that he is in fact Santa, but not the Santa that we all thought he was. He's a mall Santa who's suffered a psychotic break and hallucinated everyone in the mall as zombie elves and massacred them all. That's what this entire movie should have been about. Screw those ghost f***ers and ceiling crawling kids. Call me a Scrooge all you want, but this is what I want to be seeing in this movie. More Mr. Santa cutting off elf heads and punching Krampus in the face, mixed with a healthy dose of psychotic murderous rampage. And yeah, that's it. Thanks to my viewers over on the Discord, check it out. I've been put right into the Christmas spirit. And hopefully you have too, with this definitive, absolute list to end all lists of the best Christmas horror movies. Please don't comment better ones. And I hope you have a good time over this holiday season. Make sure you stay safe and spend it with the people you love the most, and try not to get decapitated by any killer snowmen or fuck any ghost chicks while you're at it. That's just nasty. And now it's time for the annoying YouTuber to do his annoying social media plug. That was it. That was the plug. Twitter, Instagram, both down below. And I've got to see this video off by thanking my patrons. How could I not? They watched my stupid little videos and thought, hey, this guy deserves money. I'm not sure what's wrong with you, but I certainly appreciate you and your constant support towards the channel, where at any moment YouTube can be like, yeah, nah, I don't like that. A big thank you to Dom, Hunters263, Rebecca Pitts, Total Drama Rebooted, A Dandy in Space, Martin Brannan, Natasha Twyman, Rin and Whiskey, Jarrett CBs, Nicholas, Pascal Mathis, Fighting the Pirates, Tajvia Sandhu, Richard McGowan III, Kyle York, Macy J, Reese Harford, Horatio, Jamie Thompson, Raimi Patterson, Chris, Michelle, Newcomb, and Fabian. So a big thank you to my patrons, and thank you to everyone else for watching.